talking about the audit report. Now, we've got opinions, and the opinions are in the audit report, but we've obviously got a whole report with some other items in that. And the components of the audit report are going to include the opinion letter, which is really what they're paying for. This is it. This is the big kahuna. Management's responsibilities letter, discussing. We've got a whole section on that, discussing what management's responsible for, them specifically, explicitly stating that, and a report on internal controls. The opinion letter states whether the financial statements are free from material misstatement, and the management responsibility letter states that management's responsible for the financial statements and the internal controls. Lastly, the report on internal controls states that the internal controls are effective. Do keep a note that obviously this is only going to really exist if we're dealing with an integrated audit or if we're dealing with SOC reporting. So this is not going to be in your quote unquote standard audit, right? You're not expressing an opinion over internal controls in a normal audit. Other important pieces of information in this report are going to include the name and contact information, the date of the report, the scope of the audit. All of those are going to be pretty important. Talking about these audit reports and what are we going to include for each opinion type, no matter, regardless of the opinion, it could be a perfect opinion, clean opinion, it could be an awful opinion, you could say the financial statements are an absolute mess. Regardless, what are you going to include in that audit report? Well, you're going to include references to the US as the country of origin of GAAP and GAS. Now, these are items not just here for fun. These are items that are here because, well, you could easily see them as a multiple choice question, as what's included in that audit report, or maybe a SIM. A big drop-down listing of what's included in the audit report, no matter what. Or it could say that what's included in an unmodified report, this would be included because it's included in every type regardless. We could also see references to the accounting standards or additional standards depending on the entity's categorization. So if the PCAOB was involved, if maybe the SEC, if you're reporting for specific entities, that would be included as well. The auditor's report is addressed to the entity that engaged the auditor. I'm going to say who hired you. And lastly, it explicitly represents management's and the auditor's responsibilities. Who's responsible for what? That's important for pretty much everyone. So it's important for you as the auditor to make sure that you take responsibility for only what you had control over, as well as management taking responsibility for their portions. Talking about the report release dates. This is something that we've covered in another lesson as well. I just wanted to reiterate it here, make sure we're catching it all. Make sure you've got 3 points like this memorized, right? Just memorize these items and you'll be good to go. Now, generally, what is the rule? Generally, if you are a private AIC following the AICPA, you're not a public company, you're not an issuer, you are going to have more lax rules. So per statements on auditing standards, auditors of non-issuers have 60 days after the report release date to complete the final audit file. And what is that? You release the report, maybe you get it down to the wire, it's the last day, your deadline's 4/15, let's say. Now you have 60 days from that date to complete the final audit file. And then after 60 days, I mean, I've been there where it's like, all right, pen's down, you physically cannot put anything else in the audit file. It's kind of just a nice catch-all period. If you wanted to put additional documentation, but you didn't get the chance because, well, you were focusing on really hammering down that audit opinion, hammering down the important points, that's, again, that's something that just giving you extra time to bolster the audit file, to put more evidence in there, anything like that. Now, if you are dealing with issuers, PCAOB, then you're going to have 45 days. It's just, I just memorize those, understanding that, yeah, it's a little more strict if you are dealing with issuers with the PCAOB. Now, the report release date is when the auditor grants the client permission to use the report. It's got to be explicitly stated, hey, you can now use this report for whatever it is, issuing financial statements, for giving them to a bank, for giving them to shareholders, whatever that may look like. After this period of time has passed, no deletions can be made to the audit documentation until the retention period has passed, and memorizing those from our lesson on audit documentation, you cannot delete anything. However, in this big old, let's say, big file in your file cabinet, more likely now on some drive storage on the cloud, the auditor may add documentation, can amend it or modify it, again, not deleting it. However, these additions and modifications must be made clear. You could likely maybe just have a list and say, this file was edited. Here is the old version. Here's the new version. Just making it clear, why did you do it? Are you going in to cover something up? Obviously, that is not right. That's not something you should be doing. So just making it clear why you're doing it. It could be a totally legitimate reason. You could have found out more information, or maybe there was a mathematical error or just an old piece of documentation. You just want to make it clear why you're going in and editing your work. Now, as mentioned, the audit report release date is when the retention period begins. Per PCAOB standards, an auditing firm cannot give the client permission to use the engagement report until the engagement quality reviewer provides concurring approval of issuance. Now, this is a PCAOB rule. And what this means is that, again, the auditing firm cannot give the client permission to use the report, again, to give to SEC, to give to the PCAOB, to give to the bank, to give to investors, to give to creditors, to anyone, until the engagement quality reviewer provides approval. Now, likely that's going to be another partner within the firm. That's going to be someone who can give you that quality assurance. So just something to keep in mind, something to memorize there. And the earliest date for an audit report is the date that the auditor has obtained sufficient appropriate audit evidence to support the opinion. All facts to memorize here. This is all going to be quite important for our exam, memorizing these points. So yeah, just take these notes, memorize them. You'll be good to go. Here are note disclosures. Now, as I mentioned, you can think of these paragraphs kind of as similar, like comparisons to note disclosures. Now, spoiler, this is a slide taken from FAR, and this is going over the notes of the financial statements in FAR. However, I think it's important to understand the notes of the financial statements, well, mainly because you're trying to give additional paragraphs on them. Now, the summary of significant accounting policies, that is within the notes of the financial statements. Here are items that you're going to see within this portion of the notes of the financial statements: amortization of intangibles, selected depreciation methods. So as we'll see, you may, as an auditor, give some sort of extra paragraph based on one of these items. So that's just going to be something we'll see. Basis of consolidation, criteria for which investments are cash equivalents. So again, why are we going over this? It's because you, as the auditor, may have to give an additional paragraph on one of these items. Just take a look, memorize them. If you want to memorize these for the financial exam, please feel free. You will be seeing that as well. Now we're moving along to a summary on the auditor's report. Now this is for non-issuers, as we see here, put out twice. And then we've got the next slide, which we'll have for issuers. Here, we're going to cover what happens if there's a misstatement and what happens if there's a scope limitation. And we're going to see an immaterial misstatement, an immaterial scope limitation, a material but not pervasive misstatement, and a material but not pervasive scope limitation. And then lastly, material and pervasive for both of these. We're going to see it in relation to what type of opinion should you issue in each of these circumstances. The opinion section, what is that going to state? The basis for opinion section, which is essentially elaborating upon the opinion that you give. The management's responsibility section, which we see does not change regardless of the opinion type. So I'm just going to skip that as we go through it because we're addressing it now. Management has the same responsibility no matter what. Here we see the auditor's responsibility, and that is pretty much not going to change. However, except if there's a scope limitation that is material and pervasive, essentially when we're disclaiming an opinion, as I like to say, we're getting out of there. That's going to be something where we are going to limit our responsibility because obviously we're getting the heck out of there. We're not even giving an opinion. So when you have a disclaimer of opinion, you're going to modify the auditor's responsibility section because you didn't do a full audit. Lastly, for our key audit matters section, which we'll discuss key audit matters much later, we've got critical audit matters and key audit matters. We know that key audit matters are related to non-issuers and critical audit matters are related to issuers. That's why we see this one here. We're going to see the differences here in our different options. So let's dive right in, starting with an immaterial misstatement. We have a misstatement, say $100, cash is off by $100. However, it's a multi-billion dollar company, so this is immaterial. We're going to give them a clean opinion. If there's misstatements, but they're not material, not a big deal. The opinion is going to say it fairly presents the financial statements, the picture of them, the basis for the opinion. It's a standard basis for opinion. This is what we did to get our opinion. This is what we understand the financial statements to be, management's responsibility, auditor's responsibility. And then are we going to include a key audit matter section? Well, we are going to include that when we are engaged to do that. Now, what about a material but not pervasive? We know that term to be quite intertwined with a qualified opinion, as well as the opinion that is qualified is going to say the financial statements are not materially stated except for one item. And in the basis for opinion section, we're going to amend it to describe the one item that is an issue, right? Hopefully it's not pervasive, so it's just material, it's a big deal, but it does not permeate throughout the entire financial statements. And same item here for the key audit matters section. Moving on to material and pervasive. So if there is an issue that is material, it's a big deal, and it affects the financial statements as a whole, we are going to issue an adverse opinion. And in the opinion section, we're going to say, what we see here does not fairly present the operations of the entity. We're going to amend the basis for opinion section to describe the obvious issue here. And we're not going to include a key audit matters section when we have an adverse opinion. Moving on to scope limitation. If we have an immaterial scope limitation, such as management says, hey, you can't look through our records or you can't talk to certain employees. If it's immaterial, we've got unmodified, right? Same sort of item that we saw above for an immaterial misstatement. Just a section here, nothing critical, but if it's immaterial either way, we're concerned about material. Material but not pervasive, same thing, qualified. What about the opinion section? We're going to say except for possible effects. So there's a scope limitation. We can still give an opinion. It's going to be a qualified opinion. Now, the main difference here is for the type of opinion, we can't give an adverse opinion if there's a material and pervasive scope limitation. We're just going to get out of there. We're going to disclaim an opinion, withdraw from the engagement. Now, coming back to our qualified opinion, we are going to amend to describe the matter as we see both circumstances here. And I would just memorize, again, just kind of memorize this chart, memorize what's going to happen with our key audit matter section. Are we going to include that? Are we not going to include that? Lastly here, material and pervasive, just get out of there. In our opinion section, we were engaged to audit, but we do not give an opinion because, you know, there was a scope limitation. We are going to include that in the basis for opinion section. Say, hey, guess what? Sorry, we couldn't really give an opinion. So we're getting out of there. Make sure you memorize this. Make sure you're familiar as we dive right into our issuer. Diving into issuer, we are going to see a lot of similarities, however, just some differences here. And we're going to see we're actually now having a section on if there's a lack of independence. We'll talk about that. We've got type of opinion, the opinion section, any additional paragraphs needed, the basis for the opinion. And as we saw before, it was key audit matters. Now we have critical audit matters. Moving on here, if we have an immaterial misstatement, pretty much the same as what we saw before. And for immaterial scope limitation, again, nothing crazy. Just as what we saw before, we see that we're going to have the same type of opinion as we saw for a non-issuer. If it's a material but not pervasive, we're going to have qualified, material and pervasive, we're going to have an adverse opinion. For a scope limitation, just get out of there as well. Same thing for the opinion section. Really, very similar chart, similar circumstance. Now, for additional paragraphs, are we going to need an additional paragraph for immaterial? No, we're not going to have an emphasis matter or an other matter paragraph for something that's immaterial. However, are we going to have an emphasis matter or other matter paragraph if there is a material but not pervasive? Yes. So in both circumstances, if there is a qualified or adverse or material not pervasive or material and pervasive misstatement and or scope limitation, we are going to include additional paragraphs describing those. Now, in the basis for opinion section with our issuers, we're going to have a standard all around. And then moving on to scope limitation, we are going to see that in the basis for opinion, except for, as discussed above, and then we're going to omit certain sentences in our basis for our material and pervasive scope limitation. Now, for the critical audit matters, I would just memorize, when are we going to include that? Here we have standard critical audit matters section, standard critical audit matters portion, and then when are we going to omit it? Well, when it's material and pervasive. Lastly here, if there's a lack of independence in an audit, we are going to issue a disclaimer of opinion. We're not giving anything. We're disclaiming everything. Just, again, just getting out of there. We're not providing anything. Sorry, we're getting out of here. Bye-bye. We are not going to be involved because we are not independent.
Hey there. Are you ready to not only pass your CPA exams, but truly understand and enjoy the material while studying? I know it seems impossible, right? Especially to enjoy the material? We'll do it together. Tap into the power of cpa.examprep.ai, where we've got personalized quizzes, multiple choice questions, memorization guides, flashcards, simulations, all tailored to your learning. Our adaptive study planning puts you on the fastest path to success and lifts you back up if you fall behind. Avoid wasting your precious time and money attempting an exam with a low chance of passing, because who wants that? We want to get you through this process as quick as possible. Our exam readiness prediction lets you walk in with confidence, knowing that you're prepared for success on exam day. Thankfully, there's no payment method needed to get started. So why don't you come join us? Visit cpa.examprep.ai and let's achieve your exam success together.